नमस्ते बिटिया, हमेशा खुश रहो बिटिया। मायसेल्फ डॉक्टर आरती पुरोहित, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर पैथोलॉजी डिपार्टमेंट, ज्योति विद्यापीठ, वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी। आर टुडेज टॉपिक इज, बिफोर स्टार्टिंग विद द पैरासाइटोलॉजी, वी आर गोइंग टू दिस लेक्चर, दैट इज हाउ टू स्टडी द पैरासाइटिक डिजीज एंड वाई टू स्टडी इन होम्योपैथी। So we will just before starting parasitology, we just discuss about the what exactly the parasito is and why we are going to study this parasitology in our homeopathy. So start. Medical parasitology traditionally has included the study of three major group of animals. One is parasitic protozoa, parasitic helminths, and those arthropod that directly cause the disease or act as a vector of various pathogens. A parasite is a pathogen that simultaneously injures and derives sustenance from its host. Some organisms called the parasites are actually commensals in that they neither benefit nor harm their host. For example, like ant amoeba, coli. Although parasitology had its origin in the zoologic sciences, it is totally an interdisciplinary field greatly influenced by microbiology, immunology, biochemistry, and other life sciences. Infections of the human caused by parasites number in a billions and range from relatively innocuous to fatal, and diseases caused by these parasites constitute the major human health problem throughout the world. For example, approximately 30% of the world population is infected with the nematode, that is Ascaris lumbricoides. The incidence of many parasitic diseases like schistosomiasis, malaria have increased rather than decreased in recent years. After parasitic illness have increased in importance as a result of the AIDS epidemic, like cryptosporidiasis, pneumocystic syncytial pneumonia, and strongyloidosis. The migration of parasite infected people, including the refugees from area with high prevalence rates of parasitic infection, also has added to the health problem of the certain countries. A misconception about parasitic infection is that they occur only in tropical areas. Although most parasitic infections are more prevalent in the tropics, many people in temperate and subtropical areas also become infected, and visitors to tropical countries may return with a parasitic infection. The unicellular parasite, that is protozoa, and multicellular parasite like helminths and arthropods are antigenically and biochemically complex, as are their life histories and pathogenesis of the disease they cause. During their life, parasitic organisms typically go through several developmental stages that involve changes not only in structure, but also in biochemical and antigenic composition. Some helminth larval stages have little resemblance to the adult stage, for example, those of the tapeworm and flukes. Some parasitic protozoa also change greatly during their life history, for example, Toxoplasma gondii. It is an intestinal coccidian in cats, but in human take on a different form and localize in deep tissue. Some of these infections can convert from well-tolerated or asymptomatic condition to life-threatening disease. Many parasitic infections are transmitted from animal to human, like zoonotic infections. The human disease may or may not resemble the disease caused in a lower animal host. Several general chapters of parasitology deal with the structure and classification of parasite and the mechanism of parasitic disease. Emphasis is placed throughout on the basic biology of the pathogen on their host-parasite relationship. Thus, description of the basic properties of the pathogen and pathogenesis of the disease they cause, host defenses, and epidemiology are highlighted. The practical information on clinical manifestation, diagnosis, and control has been included in the chapter on specific pathogen. Most chapters treat a group of related pathogen, for example, trematodes and cystodes. Such coverage is essential to give students the awareness and understanding necessary for proper diagnosis, treatment, and prevention of the parasitic infections. The most important element in diagnosing a parasitic infection is often the physician's suspicion that a parasite may be involved, a possibility that is too often overlooked. this kind of awareness required a knowledge of biology of the parasite. Diagnosis of parasitic infections required laboratory support. Since the signs and symptoms are often non-specific, a variety of methods and specimens are used for diagnosis. Since the most common parasite are enteric, microscopic examination of fecal specimen is done more often than any other laboratory processor in the diagnosis of parasitic disease. Culturing has little application in the diagnosis of most parasitic infection, although it has been employed. For example, for Trichomonas vaginalis and Entamoeba histolytica infection, the immunodiagnostic tests are useful in several infections, including the extraintestinal amoebiasis, visceral larval migraines, and trichinosis. Because of the laboratory is so important in the diagnosis, its personnel must be well trained. Continuing training and refresher courses should be encouraged and supported. Continuing education program in parasitology can be found in various journals. For example, the American Society for Microbiology News. So this is all about the parasitology, why parasitology is so important and how to study the parasitology. What are the topics, main contents, inhabitant is very important. What is parasite? What is its morphology? Then what are the clinical features? What are the life cycle they have? And what? How many hosts are there? Intermediate hosts, definitive hosts who have the sexual cycle, and intermediate hosts do not have asexual cycle they contains inside their body. And then after the life cycle, the diagnosis is important in which the laboratory comes, and lastly the prevention. Definitely the hygiene is best choice. Most of the parasitic infection are occurred because of E. coli transmission. Thank you.